In this lecture, we will look at into the chloroplast. What is the function of chloroplast, where it is located, and what are the organisms in which you can able to see a chloroplast? What is the difference between an oxidative phosphorylation, which we have already seen there in the electron transport chain, and what is a photophosphorylation? So these differences are we see in this lecture. So first, what is chloroplast? Chloroplast is an organelle that is responsible for events of photosynthesis in eukaryotic phototrophs. They are commonly present there in the oxygenic phototrophs. Oxygenic phototrophs refers to those organisms in which oxygen will be evolved during the final step of the photosynthesis process. Simple examples are cyanobacteria and plant system. Why they are using this term is, there is another term called as anoxygenic photosynthesis. The term anoxygenic photosynthesis refers to a process in which oxygen is not involved. You look at the point here. They extract their energy and electron source exactly from some other source other than water. Especially they are extracted from hydrogen sulfide. These organisms are of an ancient origin, presumed to have evolved before the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms or the events have started. Anoxygenic photosynthetic bacteria belong to the phylum of bacteria, okay, to the four phylums, especially purple sulfur bacteria, purple non-sulfur bacteria, green sulfur bacteria, and green non-sulfur bacteria. Purple sulfur bacteria example is a chromatium, purple non-sulfur bacteria example is a rhodospirillum, green sulfur bacteria example is a chlorobium, green non-sulfur bacteria example is a chlorofluxus. So these are the organism in which an anoxygenic photosynthesis process will be dominating. Now we look at the structure of the chloroplast. Chloroplasts are usually large. Say they are 1 to 5 micrometer wide and 1 to 10 micrometer long, and they are generally opaque. They are described in the history of cell biology by Antonín Leeuwenhoek as well as Nemea Group. These two scientists are those who have first described about the chloroplast. Chloroplast can be found there in a mature leaf, which usually contain 20 to 100 chloroplasts. Whereas algal cell typically contains only one or few chloroplasts. This is a video which showing the movement of chloroplasts there inside a plant cell. This happens through the process of cyclosis. You can able to see a lot of oxygen have been getting evolved there. As I already told, oxygen is the one which is formed as a end product during the process of photosynthesis. It appears as a simple flattened spheres in the plant system. In Spirogyra, a ribbon shaped chloroplast is a common feature. Chloroplasts are formed commonly from differentiation of proplastids, which later develop into plastids from which the chloroplast cells will be arising. Some kind of proplastids may differentiate and form into amyloplasts that are involved there in the storing of starch, whereas other proplastid may be associated with storing of the pigments. They are called as a chromoplast that are involved in pigmentation for the flowers as well as fruits. That is, it gives a distinct color. There are even other kinds of proplastids such as proteinoplasts that are involved in storing protein and elaioplasts that are involved in storing lipids. In this image, you can able to look at the appearance of chloroplasts in different kinds of organisms. Some organism will be having a very large chloroplast. Some will be having a ribbon shaped chloroplast. This is the one present there in the Spirogyra. Chloroplasts are generally composed of three membranous systems. A chloroplast like mitochondrion has both an outer membrane as well as an inner membrane, often which is separated by a narrow intermembrane space. The inner membrane encloses the stroma, that is a gel-like matrix teeming with various enzymes that are required for carbon, nitrogen and sulfur fixation and reduction and assimilations. The outer membrane is the one which found to house a lot of transmembrane proteins called as a porins that are similar to the one that is present in the mitochondria. They help in the passage of solutes and other molecular weights up to a 5000 Dalton. The inner membrane forms a significant permeability barrier, that is, transport proteins present in the inner membrane controls the movement of metabolites between the intermembrane space as well as the stroma. Only three important metabolites can freely diffuse there into both outer as well as inner membrane. They are carbon dioxide, water and oxygen. Chloroplasts have thylakoid structures. You can able to look at the thylakoid structures there in this image. So these are all the thylakoid structures that have been present there inside the chloroplast. So these thylakoid structures are the one which play an important role. Thylakoids form into the third membrane system inside the chloroplast. So this is something analogous to that of the cristae structures that have been formed there in the mitochondria, that is some foldings. Like that, here it has been some membranous folding system that create as an internal compartments. They are flat, sac-like and suspended. They are usually arranged in stacks. They are usually arranged one above other as a stack and they are called as a grana. Grana are interconnected by a network of longer thylakoids called as stroma thylakoids. So stroma thylakoids is the one which is interconnecting the grana. We now look at this image which explains the different structures present in the chloroplast. So it is having an external membrane or outer membrane, then you can able to see an inter membrane space, and inside that you can able to see a internal membrane, and you can able to see the structures such as a stroma, a matrix space in which a lot of grana are suspended as a stack like structures. And an interesting thing, you can able to see the DNA molecule that is called as a chloroplast DNA. So in the whole cellular organelles, only two organelles, which includes a mitochondria and chloroplast, are capable of cell division independently. That is, cell divides separately, whereas these structures that have been present inside the cell can go for an independent division. That is independent of the cell division. So you can able to find the thylakoids there. So these are all the arrangement of thylakoid. Thylakoid membranes are also shown there. Why we are looking into the thylakoid membrane, the most important in the chloroplast is they are the locations in which electron transport chains will be arranged. That is the place in which the photophosphorylation will be taking place. Whereas the stroma is a place in which the carbon is fixed with the help of energy and reduce the equivalents that have been synthesized there through operation of the electron transport chain and photophosphorylation process. You can also able to see the other structures such as the ribosomes that are all present inside the stroma region of the chloroplast. This has been again explained here in another image. Okay, this is also an image which explains the various structures of the chloroplast. So some important points were also mentioned there. Thylakoid membrane, as I already told, they are the locations at which ATP and NADPH are synthesized. That is the process of photophosphorylation. Whereas if you look at into the stroma, there is a matrix space in which carbon is fixed. That is, carbon dioxide is converted into cellular carbon only in the stroma region. Intermembrane space is again a very important thing. That is the thylakoid lumen. This is a space in which the proton that have been getting accumulated due to the operation of the electron transport chain. That proton is the one which could be fueling there the ATP synthase pump, which is similar to that of the mitochondria. Hello, dear students. You just look at this video, which gives an idea that how the various structures have been arranged there in the cell. Okay, you just watch this thing. These are the ATP structures that have been shown there with the electron transport chain. So you can able to see the ADP molecule is moving and it is converted there into ATP. That blue things are actually ADP molecules. So this is a photophosphorylation event that could be taking place there inside the cells. That ATP is the one which is used for the other process. Last part of this lecture describes both the process, that is the photophosphorylation as well as carbon assimilation reaction together in this image. You can see the stacks of grana that have been forming there into the thylakoid membrane system, something similar to that of the crystal folding there in the mitochondria. Here in this membrane system you can see the components of the electron transport chain are housed together. Final thing, what is the output of this process is the production of energy. So this is a thylakoid membrane upon which the various proteins that are involved there in the electron transport process have been arranged there. You can able to see two systems, that is photosystem 1 as well as photosystem 2. They are the one that are involved in the receiving sunlight and exciting the electron in the chlorophyll, and their energy is being transferred to the other chlorophyll molecule. And this is again the location in which the water molecule is splitted and from which electron is being taken for the electron transport chain. During this process only you will be getting a lot of oxygen evolution. So that is the reason why in an aerobic or oxygenic photosynthesis, oxygen is evolved during the process. So apart from these two photosystems that are functioning at a different wavelength as it has been mentioned here. Say for example, photosystem 2 functions at a 680 nanometer, that is it receives sunlight at 680 nanometer efficiently and used for the process. Whereas the photosystem 1 is of a little bit higher wavelength of a sun's light, mainly of a 700 nanometer wavelength. If you look at apart from this two photosystems, you can able to see lot of other molecules such as a plastoquinone, plastocyanin, ferredoxin and even an NADP reductase. So this NADP reductase is a final enzyme that have been present there in this electron transport chain, in which the NADP is getting reduced there into NADPH. That is a low energy electron from water end up there into the NADPH. It results in the formation of a NADPH molecule that are rich in energy. This molecule are in turn used there in the Kelvin cycle. So when this particular process has been taking place, you can able to see a lot of proton gradient has been formed here there in the thylakoid space. So this more amount of proton that have been present there in the thylakoid space will try to enter inside the ATPase pump. That results in the phosphorylation process of adenosine diphosphate into ATP. So at the end of the functioning of this photophosphorylation process, two energy rich molecules will be synthesized. One is NADPH and another one is ATP. Both these molecules are in turn used there for the Kelvin cycle. Again, this point has been very clearly depicted here in this diagram. With the help of light, light reactions are going on, in which water is the one from which the electron is derived, and during this process oxygen will be emanated or it is coming out as a byproduct. During this particular process you will be getting a lot of ATP and NADPH synthesized. They are all taken for the next process, that is the Kelvin cycle, a process in which carbon dioxide is fixed into cellular carbon, that is carbohydrate. Then it will be utilized by the cell. So that is the one it have been shown in this particular image. So ATP as well as NADPH that have been formed in the photophosphorylation process are all will be used there in the Kelvin cycle. So in the Kelvin cycle, carbon dioxide will start moving inside and carbon dioxide is assimilated there into cellular carbon. That is taking place with the help of various enzymes of the Kelvin cycle.